Yeah, good morning, everyone. We'll retrieve our comments. So I'll be chairing this section, and my name is Mingxuan Chen. So the first speak in this morning will be given by Professor Agios Ellis Wova from Venus University, and the title of his talk is Voltaic Engineering of Fractional Turned Insulators. And, okay, let's welcome him.
Is it working?
Oh, okay. So, good morning. And today I will tell you a little story about Voltaic Engineering of Fractional Turned Insulators, and the subtitle, given more specific details, is it's about coupling between micromotion and interactions. I mean, Voltaic Engineering is something that happens when you shake a system, and when you shake the system, the particles inside, they undergo some micromotion. They are moving around in real space, as far as I'm concerned, and there will be some coupling between this motion and interactions, and I will be looking at implications of that to stabilization of fractional turned insulating phases. And okay, there's an acknowledgement to a number of colleagues who contributed, who collaborated with me on this topic, and all of them come from the other side of the globe, so they are all sleeping peacefully, except for Gediminas Yuzelundas, who is present in the audience. Okay, so the outline, broadly, my talk will be composed of three parts. I will be describing a little bit what Voltaic Engineering is about. It was mentioned, but was not really described in detail in this conference, so I will spend some time on that. Then I will switch to a single particle problem. I will use Voltaic Engineering to engineer topological bands. Topological bands, I believe you know what that is. They have been mentioned in this conference quite a few times. And they are the prerequisite. You need to have them in order to think of fractional quantum colloid phases, to think of fractional turned insulating phases, as we call them. And single particle pitch is not enough, so I have been moving on to describe interactions which are needed to stabilize fractional turned insulating phases. And as already advertised, there will be some coupling to micromotion, and I will be discussing that in more detail. So the first part is about Voltaic Engineering. Good. Voltaic Engineering is a good thing, and if you want me to give a brief definition in a single sentence here, so I try to cook it up for you. And the nice thing about Voltaic Engineering, it's a form of quantum engineering. And quantum engineering is, they are grand words, they describe our ability that we have today to engineer microscopic systems, quantum mechanical systems at a microscopic level. And Voltaic Engineering is just one form of this quantum engineering that relies on a very simple thing. You take your system and you shake it. You subject it to a time-periodic external driving, and it's such a simple thing can do marvels for you. It can create all sorts of expected and unexpected properties, and you see here that controllable physical system is highlighted. It's very important that you have a system that you can control, and of course it's a hidden reference to optical lattices. The system that I will be using and many other people are using for this Voltaic Engineering, this controllable system that you can drive according to a well-defined protocol, is an optical lattice, and defined poetically, it's just optical crystal of light. Defined less poetically, it's an interference pattern created by some lasers. And the nice features that we have offered to us by those optical lattices, of course, as I said already, and probably will say a few times again, it's a very high degree of control that we have over these systems. They can have high degree of structural purity, they can be isolated from the environment very well, and all those features are very important for this type of activity. And when I'm saying that optical lattices are sort of crystals of light, artificial crystals, of course it's very suggesting to use these optical lattices to study condensed matter phenomena that you have in typical real-world condensed matter systems, which are dirty and a bit less controllable. And in this talk, I will be focusing on this particular aspect of condensed matter physics, or physics that comes from condensed matter, about inducing fractional quantum Hall physics in optical lattices. They are still elusive. They are not shown in an experiment. So let's look briefly at what happens. And okay, as far as a theorist is concerned, an optical lattice is a collection of sides and links. You have a number of sides where your particles can sit. They are numbered with a single number. And you have links connecting each side to another. And I'm seeing directed links because I'm distinguishing hopping in the one direction, I to J, from direction J to I. And this is just the vocabulary that I will be using. On this lattice, you define either bosonic or fermionic degrees of freedom. You can create, remove a particle, you can count the number of them. And the kinetic part of your Hamiltonian is described as a sum of terms of this type. You can hop from side I to side J with a certain amplitude. You can have simple single particle potentials when the density sitting on a certain side feels some energy. You can have interactions between particles, and for further reference, here I wrote a few examples. The simplest thing is, of course, on-site interaction between bosons. Each time you put two bosons, a pair of bosons on a site, it costs you an energy U. There may be interactions with neighbors, with some energy V. I divided by two to avoid double counting because I would be counting the links twice. And there may be more exotic interaction terms, such as this one, for example. You can interpret it as density. You can interpret it as density-assisted hopping. When you go from site K to site I, there may be some dependence on the particle density either on those sites or some neighboring site. And an important thing to notice that all those contributions in principle can be either natural or Fock engineering. Maybe you have them already in your static Hamiltonian. Maybe they will appear when you start driving it. And a very important thing is here, you can have in your optical lattices gauge structures, and they have to be engineered because your particles are neutral. They do not react to natural magnetic and electric fields, not directly. Of course, they react. But the way we generate gauge structures by Fock engineering is this one. We are able to make those hopping amplitudes complex. They have an absolute value, and we have some phase. And this phase picked up when the particle moves from side I to side J. Of course, it's gauge dependent. But what is physical and gauge independent is the artificial flux. You go around the plaquette, and on typical lattices, the plaquettes are maybe triangular, maybe square, maybe hexagonal. You can think of other shapes. And when you go around, you accumulate a phase phi, which acts as if it was an artificial magnetic flux. And this is, of course, very important for my problems. OK, so this slide is a very superficial, naive introduction to Fock engineering, what really happens. And to have Fock engineering, first of all, you need to have a system which is described by a Hamiltonian periodic in time. Time-dependent problems are difficult. Time-periodic problems are quite solvable. And the simplest level at which one can understand all this stuff is that, okay, your Hamiltonian is periodic in time. After a period T, you come back to the original Hamiltonian. So if you are watching your system stroboscopically at time intervals of T, then 2T, 3T, and so on, you basically don't really feel the fact that Hamiltonian is time-dependent. And if you're looking at the evolution operator over a complete cycle from time t naught to t naught plus the period, you expect that your system may be behaving as if the Hamiltonian was sort of time independent. And this is the simplest definition of the Fock Hamiltonian. You take this evolution operator during a period, and you claim, and of course that's true, that this evolution can be generated from time-independent Hamiltonian. This HF is time-independent. It is static. It drives your system through a complete period. And this little T naught down, written down here, is not a time dependence. It's parametric dependence on the origin of your cycle. If you are watching your system from one full moon to another full moon, or from one new moon to another new moon, this Hamiltonian may be a little bit different, but this is just the parametric dependence. And a very important thing to emphasize that this Hamiltonian is stationary, it is time independent. You take your system, you shake it periodically, and you realize that effectively your system is emulating some different effective Hamiltonian, which is stationary. Okay, and the essential requirements that we have here is, okay, I already mentioned them briefly, you need a very high degree of tunability. When we do Fokker engineering, we do not just shake anything. We take a well-prepared system, the system that we want, and we typically need a very specific driving protocol. So this degree of control, degree of tunability is very important. Isolation from the environment is also a very important thing. You want your system to actually follow the Hamiltonian that you engineered, not just dissipate immediately. And this Fokker Hamiltonian, or slightly more sophisticated version that I will be showing very soon, this Fokker Hamiltonian is the central object. You must be able to compute it systematically, and you must be able to interpret the terms that you get in the terms of some interesting physics that you will want to look at. Okay, and this is another, a very naive, a very simple slide, but I think it helps to understand what is really happening. Think about a very simple non-quantum mechanical system, about a train which goes from town A to B, but it moves slowly because it stops at every intermediate stop, and for example, 16 intermediate stops. And if you are watching the coordinate of your train evolving in arbitrary units of time and arbitrary units of position, your trajectory basically looks something like this. You move, then you stop, then you move, and you stop. And if you are trying to make an experiment and understand all this, it might be quite difficult. An experiment means that you get on the train and you fall asleep, and then you wake up at a random time moment, and you are trying to understand what is happening, and you don't understand what is happening, because sometimes the train is speeding, sometimes it's standing still. And it's easy to realize that to analyze this sort of behavior, you can very easily to separate it into a superposition of two components. On the average, in the long time, the train is moving. Doesn't matter if it is moving slowly, but it is progressing at some average, probably quite low speed, and it will take you from town A to town B. And on top of that, long time trend, which basically is a linear evolution, on top of that, you have some little wiggles that I will call micromotion. And those wiggles basically tell you that sometimes the train is moving faster than average, sometimes it's standing still, so you have some little oscillation about zero, which in many cases you can ignore, because if what really matters to you is what happens in the long term. So the basic idea, even in this neighboring example, is clear. Periodically driven system can be analyzed by separating the dynamics into two components. You have long-term effective dynamics, and you have some micromotion that happens periodically on the scale of one period. Okay, let's do the same thing at a slightly more sophisticated level with quantum mechanics. So this is a precise statement underlying the Fokker engineering, and basically this one, you are giving a system which is described by a Hamiltonian, periodic in time. After period T, the Hamiltonian comes back to its original form, and the quantum mechanical evolution operator, which tells you everything, is basically formally this one. And notice that in contrast to my previous simple example, where I was following stroboscopic evolution, I'm not doing that anymore. This time evolution operator U can take you from arbitrary time T1 to arbitrary time T2. Doesn't matter where they happen on the scale of the period. And the precise statement, a rigorous theorem, is this one. It says that for a system which is described by a time periodic Hamiltonian, you can factorize this time evolution operator for arbitrary times t1 and t2 into three factors. This thing in the middle is the most important one. It describes the time evolution given by time-independent stationary effective Hamiltonian HF. This thing written in blue simply says that you have a stationary Hamiltonian which takes you from time t1, t2 as if there was no driving. And here at the ends, at the initial time, at the final time of your experiment, you have a unitary operator, which is called the micromotion operator, which takes care of the exact switching on and switching off moments, and this UF and that UF is the same thing, only one of them has a dagger. And it is, this micromotion operator is time periodic. It repeats itself after a period, and it's unitary. Okay, so if you are not really interested in the micromotion very much, you have a very simple answer to your problem. And what everything that remains is to calculate in some specific controlled manner the Fokker Hamiltonian, this HF, and if you wish, the micromotion operator UF, and not only to calculate but also to understand what you are doing. Okay, and basically there is a very simple recipe how one constructs this Fokker Hamiltonian, and the recipe is basically this one. We call it the inverse frequency expansion. We think that the frequency, the energy scale h bar times the driving frequency omega is the dominant energy scale. And since your driven Hamiltonian, the Fokker Hamiltonian, since it is time periodic, you can always expand it in Fourier series. This HS is the Fourier component number S, evolving at frequency S times basic frequency omega. And those Fourier components are the building blocks which allow you to construct the effective Hamiltonian order by order, according to this prescription here. So when we construct the effective Hamiltonian, we build it step by step in inverse powers of the frequency. So we have first contribution, second, and so on. And typically we truncate it at some finite order j. We do not want to sum all the series to infinity, basically for that reason that we want to control and understand what is happening. And this is the notation I will be using. Those are 1, 2, 3, and in parentheses, the individual contribution, and this j in square brackets means that I am approximating the Fokker Hamiltonian, taking into account the first j terms. And those individual contributions, the first, the second, and the third, can be constructed, as I said, from the Fourier components of your driven Hamiltonian in a very simple way. The first contribution is simply the zero Fourier component, that's the average. The second contribution is composed from this sort of commutators of all Fokker Fourier components except the zeroth one. And you can easily see that if this HF first had the same scale as the Hamiltonian, here you have two Hamiltonians, so this energy scale to the second power divided by frequency, and in the third order you have three energy scales of your Hamiltonian divided by the frequency squared. So if the frequency is really the dominant energy scale, you are probably converging to something. And here, at the third order, the formulas get a little bit complicated, so I'm not writing all the contributions. I'm focusing on this first one, which has in it the zero Fourier component. Those contributions that I'm skipping here, they are dependent only on higher Fourier components, not the zeroth one. So I will not need them in my talk, but okay, they exist. And this is a little bit of advertisement. Recently we did some work to generalize the previous scheme to a very practical situation. What happens if your time-dependent Hamiltonian is not strictly periodic in time, but the amplitude of this periodic shaking is slightly growing or slightly slowly decaying, and this is very important for practical schemes. When we do experiments and want to shake a system, they like to turn on the shaking sometimes and turn it off slowly and nicely. So slowly means slowly on the scale of the driving period. So we tried and we did some generalization of that scheme that I showed you on the previous slide. Basically, your Fourier components become dependent on the slow time. This tau means that means the dependence on the slow modulation. The Fourier components become slowly time dependent. The inverse frequency expansion is copy-pasted from the other slide, but there is some dependence on t. Everything here is slowly increasing or slowly decaying. And this expansion basically tells you that at the first two levels you have pretty much the same expressions, but there is parametric dependence on time everywhere. At this level you have also an additional contribution where you have a commutator of your Fourier component with the derivative of your Fourier component. But this, as I said, is a little bit of an advertisement. In my present talk today, those guys will not be contributing in any way. So let me come back to the expansions that I showed you before. And this is something that I mentioned already. Those are the essential requirements for Fourier engineering to be either practical, or both practical and meaningful. And I would like to stress it once again, it is important. When you do Fourier engineering, when you are constructing the effective Hamiltonian, you have to make it meaningful. It has to have a simple, clear interpretation, physical interpretation, and this interpretation basically forms the basis for experiments. And talking of interpretation, you can probably realize very easily that this first order contribution to the effective Hamiltonian given by the zero Fourier component simply means time averaging. If you are driving your system very rapidly, the frequency is very high, you can neglect all the other terms and simply average your original driven Hamiltonian. And what happens in practice, this typically leads to some parameter renormalization. If you have a hopping amplitude J from side A to side B, when you shake your lattice rapidly, it gets multiplied by some Bessel function and that's it. No more wonders. And if you look at this expression for the second order contribution, as I showed you, it is composed of those funny commutators of some Fourier components of your Hamiltonian. And if you try to calculate this, you simply realize that this has a very simple physical meaning. It's a combination of two individual processes into a combined process. And this is very important and very practical. And here is a simple sketch of what happens. This is basically, it refers to emulation of the Haldane model in a shaken hexagonal lattice. So if you look at those red lines, the red lines are connecting the nearest neighbors, and they mean the original static Hamiltonian. In the original Hamiltonian, you have only couplings to the nearest neighbors. When you start to shake it circularly and do it sufficiently slowly so that the second order terms are important, what basically happens is that this commutator is able to combine one transition with another transition with a combined next nearest hopping, shown here in the green line and in the green line. And if you shake your system circularly, you are able to generate those plaquettes penetrated by fluxes plus pi half or minus pi half through those triangular plaquettes. And in this way, you can generate the flux configuration as it was envisioned by Haldane. Okay, and in my talk, I will be going beyond that. I will be looking at the third order contribution, which, as we remember from two slides ago, it was given by nested commutators of this sort. And you can easily realize that if one tries to calculate this stuff, you are basically combining three processes into some grand total. And in my talk, I will be mostly interested in combining hopping and particle interactions. Basically, you have particles on two neighboring sides. They do not interact. One of them can hop onto this side, interact with this particle, and hop off. So this leads to some effective additional interactions. Okay, so let me go very briefly through the single particle stuff, engineering single particle topological bands. And this is basically the model that we considered in one of our publications. This is a simple model that can create a topological band structure for you. And basically, briefly, It relies on circular shaking of a square lattice in the presence of some modulation. So we start with a square lattice shown here. The yellow dots are sites. The blue lines are tunneling connections connecting those sites. So the first thing we do, we damage our lattice. We modulate it in a checkerboard fashion. We divide it into two sub-lattices, A shown in yellow and B shown in blue. And we lower on-site energy on sub-lattice B by some energy, which I call minus H bar omega, because I know in advance that I will be shaking at some frequency omega, so that could be some reference scale for me. And when that happens, those full lines became dotted lines. That is, there are no direct transitions anymore. And in order to restore the tunneling between sub-lattices A and B, you have to shake this lattice at a certain frequency. Then you have photon potential marks assisted hoppings from sub-lattice A to sub-lattice B. And to skip all the details, basically what happens after that, it's not very difficult to understand. When you drive your system, when you shake it circularly, you will be generating a time-dependent Hamiltonian, the driven Hamiltonian, which has this structure. You can start from any site on sub-lattice A and hop to all neighboring sites 1, 2, 3, 4 on sub-lattice B with some hopping matrix elements, J, mu of T. They are dependent both on time and on the direction. And of course, there is a conjugate term, it means you can come back. And the structure of this time-dependent hopping is basically this one, the red thing. The exponent appears because of this energy detuning between the two sides. And since you are shaping circularly, there is a sign appearing here. And those are the lagging phases. When you hop from sublattice A to sublattice B, you can hop in four different directions. And since you are your force is rotating, there is a phase lag along those four directions. It's inserted here. And quite important thing is this output here, the parameter, the dimensionless parameter that will be showing everywhere on my slides is basically this one. F is the amplitude of the force that you are using to drive your system. D is the distance between the lattice times. So F times D is basically the energy difference created by this force. And if you divide it by H bar omega, this is the scaled shaking strength. And, okay, I have the time-dependent Hamiltonian. I can extract the Fourier components from it according to my prescription. And using those Fourier components, I can construct the effective Hamiltonian. And here's a very important question. Shall I work in the high frequency scheme when the effective Hamiltonian is approximated by taking into account only one term, and this one term is just the time average Hamiltonian? Or maybe I should work at not high frequency regime, but some intermediate, slightly lower frequency regime, where besides the first term, also the second one contributes, and the second one is given by this expression I'm just reminding you. And yeah. Actually, there will be also a third term contributing. And very briefly, this is the explanation. To the first order, to the lowest order, if you are trying to approximate your Hamiltonian with a time average Hamiltonian, you get your effective Hamiltonian in sigma matrix notation of in this funny form. You can hop from sublattice A to sublattice B, but not directly from sublattice A to sublattice A. And for this reason, you have zeros here, and this vector H has some finite components Hx and Hy, and sometimes those components Hx and Hy vanish, and this happens at the center and at the corner of the Brillouin zone. And here I have conical energy bands. Okay, so that is fine. And if I include also the second order, this is a very important thing, because when you combine two hoppings to nearest neighbors from sublattice A to sublattice B, the combined process gives you hopping on the same sublattice from A to A or from B to B, and you will be generating also the sigma Z term here in the Hamiltonian. And these terms are responsible for opening gaps at direct points, and it's very easy to answer the question whether or not my band structure will be topological. In order to have a topological band structure in this simple two-level model, I need my vector H to cover the whole block sphere, so it has to visit both the north pole, both the north pole and the south pole, and basically at Dirac points when Hx and Hy vanish, this Hz must change sign, moving from one Dirac point to another Dirac point. And the answer to the question whether or not it is possible in my model is simple. I have a parameter free space, I vary my parameters, and it is possible in some broad ranges of the parameter free space, and my parameter free space is basically shown here in those two graphs. On the vertical axis is the alpha, the shaping strength. On the horizontal axis is another parameter, beta, which is inverse frequency. J, which is the hopping matrix element, the typical energy scale of my system divided by H bar omega. And of course, beta is either less than one or much less than one, because I still want H bar omega to dominate. And in those two graphs, I am showing my information in two forms. Basically, the quantity that I am plotting is the gap that separates the two topological bands. I want this gap to be big. But on this new graph, I'm looking at this gap simply in terms of J, whether it is big or not. And on this graph, I am comparing it to the bandwidth. And this ratio, the single particle gap divided by the bandwidth is a nice quantity called flatness. It tells you how flat your bands finally are. If you want to have large flatness, you need to have narrow bands. And in this model, you can easily reach flatnesses up to 4. So this gives you some hope that you may be able to stabilize fractional phases, because interactions might be important on the scale of the bandwidth. And when I will talk about the many-body physics, I will be zooming on this dotted area here. So I have a broad range of betas, of shaking frequencies, and I have some range of alphas. And here I have some intense red color, which tells me that probably those interactions might be able to stabilize the fraction churn insulating phase here. Okay, so let me move to the last part about the interactions and the coupling of micromotions. I will be including in my modeling simple bosonic interactions on site, written in this simple form. I'm not including interactions with neighbors directly in the driven Hamiltonian, but as I already advertised, in the effective Hamiltonian, due to some strange processes combining hopping and interactions, they will be appearing, and I will comment on them. And bosons seem to be more promising to me because of the availability of the on-site repulsion and no need for, in principle, no need for interactions with neighbors. And it's very simple then. You had a time-dependent Hamiltonian before. It did not include interactions, so I simply include interactions into the driven Hamiltonian by including this extra term. And the nice thing about this extra term that it is time-independent. I'm not shaping the interactions directly. I'm not trying to moderate them in time. This is time-independent, so what happens to the Fourier components of my driven Hamiltonian is simply that the zeroth component, the static component, is modified by including those interactions here, and all other Fourier components are just the same. And the important question to ask here is what happens to the effective Hamiltonian? And of course, we take our recipe of constructing the contributions to the effective Hamiltonian order by order. In the lowest approximation, everything is just nice. Those interactions, they are copy-pasted, and they will appear in the effective Hamiltonian in the same form as before. The second contribution does not depend on the zeroth Fourier component, so this stays unchanged, which is very nice again. My gauge structure, my gaps that separate single particle topological bands, they do not suffer, this is unchanged. And those are the strange things that will be happening in the third order. The interactions will be included in some funny way. You have to calculate commutator, which HS and H minus S. And these interactions will not be limited to on-site anymore. They will be some strange interactions. And I'm asking several questions about those interactions. Are they important? Do I understand them? And I will try to answer these questions now. How much time do I have for that?
15 minutes.
Oh, probably including questions, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so I will not need probably 15 minutes for that. But okay, since we are not able to answer everything analytically, we will be doing numerical simulations. So a very brief explanation of what we did. We did exact generalizations on a finite lattice taking 4x4 elementary cells. And remember, my cells are two side cells. There is sublattice A and sublattice B. So this gives me 32 sides. If you think in the reciprocal space, you have a grid 4x4 in the Brillouin zone. And on this grid, you are supporting two bands. And looking for fractional whole bases for bosons, I'm throwing it 8 bosons so that the upper band is empty, lower band is half filled. For bosons, you are expecting the most prominent fractional phase at filling 1/2. And the numerical experiments are asked to answer those simple questions, whether or not we get the ground state manifold that looks as it was expected of fractional charge insulating phases. And is this ground state manifold protected by any body gap from excited states? And to give a little bit more details, some comments on those numerical simulations. One thing you might be wondering is that my lattice is probably too small, but this is part of the trick. We go to slightly smaller lattices like this in order to be able to do extensive looping over all sorts of parameters covering the phase space on a fine grid. And when we see something interesting, of course, we repeat the calculations with slightly as much as we can with larger lattices. But then we only need to sample the parameter space on some points on the more sparse grid. So this saves time. And of course, we would be happy to repeat those calculations with larger and larger lattices to arrive to the thermodynamic limit. But that's indeed very hard because the numerical cost blows up exponentially. And another comment is, of course, about the boundary conditions. This was described in some previous talks, so I will not go too deeply into the details. But basically, we introduced periodic boundary conditions to wrap our finite sample into a torus, and we are able to set fluxes, artificial fluxes, gamma 1 and gamma 2. When you have a torus, you can put an artificial magnetic field through the hole in the middle, and you can put artificial magnetic field through or circulating around the torus. So this gives you, this is implemented by simply some twisted boundary conditions. This gives you another pair of parameters, gamma 1 and gamma 2, and in this way you can define your many-body Brillouin zone. You can calculate the Chern numbers in this many-body Brillouin zone. And we are able to follow the so-called flux flow, which is just another indication of whether or not we can hope to have fractional Chern insulating phases. And in order to explain what that is, I need to show a picture finally. So these are the typical results of our simulations. And here's a bit of the jargon. This one says micromotion, admitted micromotion included. Of course, what we mean is that what we mean is this coupling between hopping and interactions, but I mean this hopping that appears in the third order contribution to the flock engineering, it is related to micromotion in the real space. So if written fully, this should say that we are looking for those induced interactions from coupling from micromotion to interaction events. And basically those two panels correspond to simulations performed at this level and at that level of approximation. In the first simulation, we include only the first and the second order terms in the detected Hamiltonian, and here we also add this third order term. And since we see obvious differences, of course, we suspect that those induced interactions coming from this term are important. And what you see here in general, in this particular example, that including those interactions makes my matters slightly worse. Here I had a nice ground state manifold of two intertwining states composing the ground state manifold, as expected, of the fractional charge insulating states. And all the excited states were separated by a big gap. Here, when I included this third term, this ground state is broadened and the band gap is smaller. And basically this quantity, this delta, separating the ground state manifold from the excited states is taken as a measure of the robustness of the fractional insulating phase. It depends, of course, on gamma 1 and gamma 2, on those artificial boundary conditions. And if we minimize it, we define a quantity delta, which is the many-body gap. And okay, the phase diagram for many-particle problem is shown here. Again, two panels with micro-motions ignored and micro-motions included. And this square is that dotted area that I was advertising on the single particle picture. And when you see some intense color, which means that we found fractional the ground state characteristic of the fractional churn insulator, and it is separated by a large gap from the excited states. And when you see something white, it's either we don't have the fractional phase at all or the gap is very small. And alpha, beta are the same parameters. This is a reminder of what they are. And we see that this phase diagram of the area where you can hope to find the fractional charge insulating phases is modified by interactions. And to understand this more deeply, I cover it with four typical points, A, B, C, D, and I will be looking at each of them individually, trying to understand what is happening. Sometimes nothing changes much, as at those points A and B, they seem to be similar on both graphs. Indeed, I was hoping to have a fractional churn insulating phase, but my hopes were destroyed by including those micromotions. And at point C, it's the other way around. I thought that I would not have the fractional insulating phase, but something happened, and the phase diagram extends into this point. So a little bit of analytical work is this. So the third order contributions, they come in this funny form, the double commutator with the nested commutator of Hamiltonian with two hopping events, basically. We can separate the kinetic contributions, which I will not be describing, and coupling of interactions to two hoppings, which I will look more closely at this commutator. So if you try to calculate this commutator, of course, there are lots of Bessel functions and exponents. But the most important thing you need to do to understand the physics is this double commutator. You have interaction on side I, coupling from K to J, coupling from M to L, summing over everything. And when you try to calculate to expand this commutator, when you write out all the terms, it turns out that you see something familiar. Some of those terms that you have calculated are of a very simple form. This is simply the on-site interaction, and of course, when I calculate this commutator, what I have here is not the complete answer, but also only those terms that remind me of on-site interaction. So I put this letter R here. This is reduction or renormalization of on-site interaction. When I calculate this commutator, I have simply additional contributions to on-site repulsion energy. And what I had before, I had interactions of this type. They are simply changed from energy U to energy U plus U with negative delta U. So due to shaking, your on-site interactions got slightly weaker. And when I look at remaining terms of this double commutator, again, I can identify something that looks very similar. Although it's not obvious here, but those IM, IL are nearest neighbors. Even though I didn't have interactions between nearest neighbors before, due to my shaking, they start appearing. And in my effective Hamiltonian, I will be generating terms of this type. And notice that there is a conservation law. How much your on-site interaction energy was reduced, everything was redistributed on the nearest neighbors. Delta U is negative, delta V is positive. And this Z is, of course, the coordination number. How many neighbors each sign has, and it has to be divided by two because you need to avoid double count. And still beyond that, there are more complicated contributions, which can be interpreted as pair tunneling events and density-assisted hoppings. I will not be writing them out explicitly, but they exist. And basically, this is the summary. The third order contribution to the effective Hamiltonian consists of those three terms: weakening on-site repulsion, inducing repulsion between neighbors, and all the rest, which is X or exotic. And this suggests an idea of a more sophisticated numerical simulation. I can look at those contributions one by one. At the lowest level of approximation, I throw everything away. I say I'm not interested in the micromotion-induced interactions. This is a reference simulation to compare to. Then I can think this way. If I include the on-site repulsion, okay, this weakens the interactions. Probably this is not good for the fractional churn insulating states, so let me try to simulate at this level approximation and see what happens. Then at the second step, I realize that my on-site interactions are not simply weakened. They are spread onto the nearest neighbor, so I include both contributions and see what happens. And finally, I can include everything and see the complete result and to understand what really happens due to those density-dependent tunneling events. Okay, so this is the slide you saw before. For reference, those four points, A, B, C, D, and I will be looking at each of them individually. And I'm looking at point 8 now. I'm running four different simulations, ignoring micromotions, including only weakening the on-site repulsions. I include nearest neighbor interactions, I include everything. And on this view graph, you see the many, you see the plot which shows how the many body gap scales as the function of the interaction strength U. And you see four lines just nicely lying on top of that, so basically nothing matters. I can calculate that this level of approximation includes something, nothing really happens, and the answer is very simple. I'm working here in the high frequency regime. This beta, you see, the shaking frequency is 20 times larger than the scale of your Hamiltonian, so micromotion is simply unimportant, you are not seeing anything here. Let's look to point B. Here is some difference. You calculated, we calculated the many body gap ignoring the micromotions. When we include only the weakening of on-site repulsion, you can see that the gap dropped down, it became much smaller. Well, not much smaller, on this scale it's considerably smaller. We included also repulsion between nearest neighbor, and the blue line hopped up. And when we include all the terms of the Hamiltonian, I mean this magenta line is at this end also at the same level as the black line. So you can see on the phase diagram not much has changed. And the conclusion here is that micromotion induced interactions are important. On-site interactions are spread, but the consequences are very small for the final result. There are different interactions, but still you have a nice many-body gap. At point C, we have some mess. If you ignore the micromotion, you get this black line down here, which is around zero. It basically says that you almost don't have the many-body gap. When you include the fact that your on-site interactions are weakened, you go even worse. But when you include the repulsion between nearest neighbors and also those more exotic terms, you hop up again. And this is what happens in this regime, is that the nearest neighbor interactions, as well the exotic terms a little bit, they actually help to stabilize the fractional churn insulating phase. And finally, we need to look at this last point D, where micromotion will be destroying the fractional churn insulating phase, and this is basically what happens. If you ignore micromotion, you seem to have some positive many-body gap. If you include only weakening on-site repulsion, you drop down. When you include the fact that nearest neighbors also interact, you are sort of restoring the result, but then when you include all those density-assisted hoppings and pair tunnelings, you go below zero. You don't have a many-body gap anymore. So the conclusion here is that fractional churn insulating phase is destroyed by density-dependent hoppings. Okay, so this is just a summary. Technical conclusions: we looked at a particular scheme of Floquet engineering. we needed to have not very high driving frequency, but moderately high driving frequency. To have second order terms contributing, they were important. And we were able to analyze the interplay between large real space micromotion interactions. One of good conclusions is that on-site interactions were spread onto nearest neighbors, but this does no harm for fractional churn insulating phases. But in contrast, at lower frequencies, we saw that the fractional churn insulating phases were destabilized mainly by those exotic, as they call them, hopping events. Thank you.
Any question?
So if you change the periodic boundary condition to open boundary condition, would you observe edge states in the system? And if you include micromotion, those edge states will be robust to the inclusion of micromotion and interactions?
Okay, so the first part is yes, if you open the boundary conditions, it's more difficult, at least numerically, but you can, in principle, have fractional churn insulating phase on the sample with open boundary conditions. You can have the edge states, but what really happens to the interplay of micromotion with those edge states, I can't really answer. Maybe we should check. It's an open question and it's a good question.
Your effective Hamiltonian is energy conserving, but on the other hand, we know that the driven system should equilibrate at long times to a T equal infinity temperature valve. So at some, there's some crossover scale where your approach will break down and you have to include actual relaxation. So can you estimate where this crossover time takes place?
Ourselves, we did no work on this so-called heating or on this destruction of those of this time energy conserving Hamiltonian, but we are relying on other people's work where basically there are arguments that in many practical circumstances this heating sets in quite late on the scale of your experiment, so you might be able to see things, but if you want actual numbers, numerical estimates, when exactly that happens, well, I don't have them.
Yeah, but